Hey everyone, and welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to be talking about something called dead weight loss. In this video, we'll explain what it is, when it occurs in a market, and how to determine the actual value of that dead weight loss. In this video, we'll be showing you absolutely all of the steps to calculate start to finish, so don't worry, just follow along and you'll be able to solve any dead weight loss problem. With that said, let's get into it. So when talking about dead weight loss, it's important to understand two concepts that we've already covered on the channel, and that is producer surplus and consumer surplus. Now we have multiple videos dedicated to these concepts on the channel, so please feel free to check those videos out. We'll link them in the description and then come back to this video once you feel like you have a grasp on those two concepts. The reason you need to know those concepts first is because the dead weight loss is a loss in total surplus. And total surplus is just the sum of consumer surplus and producer surplus. So you need to know that first. We'll be starting off just like we did in our surplus video, where we draw an axis, a general supply and demand intersection, and then of course we label this with all the generic supply and demand graph information. So price, quantity, P star, Q star, supply, and demand. Now, the information that we need to calculate actual values are the supply and demand equations. And in this case, I'll use the same supply and demand equations I did in my other video. That way, it's easy for you to follow along if you're jumping between the two of them. In this case, quantity demanded, or the demand equation, is equal to 270 minus 5p, and the supply equation is quantity supplied is equal to 10p. We'll put these up to the side, and then we'll use these to solve for deadweight loss. Similar to calculating total surplus, the first thing we need to do is calculate P star and Q star. And once again, you do that by setting QD equal to QS and then solving. So setting the supply and demand equations equal to one another, we get 270 minus 5P is equal to 10P. Simplifying this, we get 270 equals 15p, and finally p star is equal to 18. I'm going to take this p star and sub it into one of my equations. In this case, I'm going to choose quantity supplied since it's an easier equation to solve, and then I go through and solve for q star. So q star is equal to 10 times the new p, which is 18, and 10 times 18 is 180. So now I have my q star and my p star, so I'm going to sub those in on my graph. Again, I glossed over calculating P star and Q star because we do have videos on the channel for that. So if it's something you're struggling with, please check those videos out, become more comfortable with it, and then come back to this video where we learn dead weight loss. Now, reminding you of our other video where we talked about total surplus, consumer surplus is the area below the demand curve and above the selling price. On the contrary, producer surplus is above the supply curve and below the selling price. So these two triangles are what we calculated in our previous video. However, in this example, the market is in equilibrium. But what happens if the market isn't in equilibrium? Well, in that case, we would experience something called a deadweight loss. And formally, this is just a loss in the total surplus when the quantity traded is less than the competitive equilibrium. So if Q traded on the market, in this case, is less than 180. Well, when would that happen? One example, the example we're going to explore today, is if the government imposes something called a price floor. If the government employs a price floor, then they're going to set the minimum price, in this case, equal to 30, which is strictly higher than the equilibrium price. When the government does this, they're creating a surplus in the market, because now you can see that quantity supplied is strictly greater than quantity demanded at a price of 30. And that makes sense because of the law of supply and the law of demand. But now we have a new quantity being traded at, and this is the intersection of the demand curve and the new price line. And this can be denoted as Q floor, or the quantity traded at this price floor. As you can see, Q floor is strictly less than 180, and therefore we know there's going to be some deadweight loss. But let's calculate exactly how much deadweight loss occurs in a real number. So going back to our previous triangles, we know that the consumer surplus is the green triangle and the producer surplus is the pink triangle. Recall the definition of consumer surplus and producer surplus. Consumer surplus is above the market price and below the demand curve. Producer surplus is above the supply curve and below the market price. Well, the market price is no longer 18. Now we're setting it to 30. So we're actually going to see a change in consumer surplus and producer surplus. They're still denoted by the same colors, but they look a little bit different. consumer surplus has now shrank drastically. It's still below the demand curve and above the new selling price. And the pink triangle is, well, no longer a triangle. However, it is the area below the selling price and above the supply curve. What about that triangle in the middle that seems to be left out? Well, it's actually our deadweight loss. It's the loss in total surplus, that is the loss in consumer surplus plus the loss in producer surplus added together. But what if our teacher or professor wants us to calculate the magnitude of the deadweight loss? How do we do that? Well, there's two key numbers that we don't know just yet that we need to solve. The first is Q floor. And I'm pointing up here for Q4 because Q floor intersects the demand curve at a price of 30. The other point we need is where Q floor intersects the supply curve. So these two values are what we're going to solve for next. Once again, we're trying to calculate the area of that yellow triangle. So the only dimension we don't know yet is the base, and we need these two values to figure it out. Because we're no longer in equilibrium, we don't actually need that 18 anymore. So I'm going to clear it out of the way so that it's less confusing on our graph. The first thing we're going to do is calculate the intersection of the demand curve with the new price floor. And how we do that is by subbing in the price floor into the demand equation. So we have Q floor is equal to 270 minus 5 times 30. That 30 is the price floor value. And that's going to tell us where the demand curve intersects with the price floor line of 30. Simplifying this, we get 270 minus 150. And of course, that gives us a value for the Q floor of 120 units. So let me denote that on my graph. But I still need to know that intersection point where the supply curve intersects with Q equals 120. And to do that, I'm going to sub the Q value of 120, or the Q floor value, into the supply equation, and then solve for P. Upon doing that, I get an equation which looks like 120 equals 10P. Isolating for P, I get a P value of 12. And that P represents the corresponding price when the quantity supplied is equal to 120. So now I have all the values I need to calculate the area of that yellow triangle. I no longer need the supply and demand equation, so I'm going to get rid of them. Recall that the area of a triangle is simply base times height divided by 2. And in this case, the base is the difference between 30 and 12, which is 18. And the height of this triangle is the difference between 180 and 120, which is 60. The yellow triangle represents deadweight loss, so then we can say that deadweight loss is equal to base times height divided by 2, which is 18 times 60 divided by 2. Upon simplifying this, we can get a value for deadweight loss of $540. Once again, total surplus and deadweight loss are typically in terms of dollars, so this is how you'd write it answering a question on a test. I hope that this video helped you conceptualize what deadweight loss is, but more importantly, how to calculate it given the supply and demand equations and a change in price. If you found this video helpful, let us know by liking the video, subscribing to the channel, and of course, let us know in the comments section what sort of economic videos and homework questions you'd like to see us cover in the future. Thanks for watching this video, and we'll catch you in the next.